The Art of Manliness, Classic Skills and Manners for the Modern Man, by Brett and Kate McKay. Narrated by Todd McLaren. Copyright 2009 by Brett and Kate McKay. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with F&W Media and was produced in the year 2011 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto.
It is not the critic who counts, not the man who points out how the strong man stumbles, or where the doer of deeds could have done them better. The credit belongs to the man who is actually in the arena, whose face is marred by dust and sweat and blood, who strives valiantly, who errs, who comes short again and again because there is no effort without error and shortcoming, but who does actually strive to do the deeds, who knows great enthusiasms, the great devotions, who spends himself in a worthy cause, who, at the best, knows in the end the triumph of high achievement, and who, at the worst, if he fails, at least fails while daring greatly, so that his place shall never be with those cold and timid souls who neither know victory nor defeat.
Theodore Roosevelt. Introduction. He is going to be known as a sort of boy's hero. He is going to be known preeminently for his manliness. There is going to be a Roosevelt legend. I have grieved most deeply at the death of your noble son. I have watched his conduct from the commencement of the war, and have pointed with pride to the patriotism, self-denial, and manliness of character he has exhibited. After all, the greatest of Washington's qualities was a rugged manliness, which gave him the respect and confidence even of his enemies. These quotes are taken from 19th-century writings, and use the word manliness in a way quite foreign to the modern listener as a great compliment. In times past, manliness was a worthy and distinct characteristic, like intelligence, bravery, and humor. It was a quality that boys strive to attain, and men wish to have attached to their name. A man who had mastered the art of manliness embodied many, if not all, of these manly characteristics. Looks out for and is loyal to his friends and family. Does the right thing, even when it's not convenient, is proficient in the manly arts, treats women with respect and honor, serves and gives back to his community, sacrifices for the good of others, works hard and seldom complains, exhibits both great courage and tender compassion, has a confident swagger, but isn't a pompous jerk, is witty without succumbing to sarcasm, embraces instead of shirks responsibility. You probably have grandfathers who exemplify this kind of honorable manliness. But something happened in the last 50 years to cause these positive manly virtues and skills to disappear from the current generations of men. Fathers have ceased passing on the art of manliness to their sons, and our culture, nervous to assign any single set of virtues to one sex, has stripped the meaning of manliness of anything laudatory. Discouraged from celebrating the positive aspects of manliness, society today focuses only on the stereotypical and negative aspects of manhood. Sadly, manliness has come to be associated with the dithering dads of televisions, sitcoms, and commercials, the shallow action dudes of cinema who live to blow stuff up, and the meatheads of men's magazines who covet six-pack abs above all else. Our goal with this book is to hopefully encourage a new generation of men to pick up where their grandfathers left off in the history and legacy of manliness. Many people have argued that we need to reinvent what manliness means in the 21st century. Usually, this means stripping manliness of its masculinity and replacing it with more sensitive feminine qualities. We argue that manliness doesn't need to be reinvented. The art of manliness just needs to be rediscovered. While no book could ever fully cover all the positive qualities and essential skills every man should possess, we hope this book can at least get men started down the path of rediscovering the lost art of manliness. We've divided the book into several sections, reflecting the different roles a man assumes throughout his life. Within each section, we discuss a sampling of the attributes and skills that many men today have never learned. You can listen to the book straight through, or you can skip to parts that you find more interesting or pertinent to your own life. Don't let this book be the end of your journey to rediscover the lost art of manliness. It should only be the beginning. Thousands of men before us have left behind nuggets of wisdom that describe what it means to be a man. And if you look hard enough, you can find men in your own life who can teach you the important skills and qualities of true manhood. Seek out great men, both past and present, and in time, you'll become a virtuoso of the art of manliness. Note to listeners, not only have many of the skills of the men of yesteryear been lost over time, so is a great deal of the colorful language that was once spoken in the streets and saloons of 19th century cities. We've given this book a smart sprinkle, a good deal, of these old-time phrases and expressions. So, if you come across a word that sounds like something your great-great-great-grandpa might have said, it probably is. Also, because the oft-used douchebag is getting as old as bling-bling, we've peppered this book with unique insults from our manliest president, Theodore Roosevelt. T.R. was master of the creative, yet cutting, put-down. Chapter 1. The Gentleman. This is the final test of a gentleman. His respect for those who can be of no possible service to him. William Lyon Phelps. For centuries, well-bred men were trained in all the manly arts, from the skills needed to be a soldier to the proper etiquette for dinner parties. They were quintessential gentlemen, dapper in dress, polite in conduct, yet every bit a true man. Unfortunately, many modern men place the gentleman on the sissy end of the manliness spectrum, opposite that of the burping, unshaven, uncouth man's man. Yet our forebears understood that there was no contradiction in being ruggedly manly and a refined gentleman. George Washington, Theodore Roosevelt, and Robert E. Lee are some examples of men who combined gritty manliness with gentlemanly bearing. They paid attention to how they dressed, groomed and conducted themselves, and were as comfortable at a stately ball as they were on the battlefield. And the desire to be a gentleman was not restricted to the rich or powerful either. Emily Post's Etiquette was the most requested book by GIs during World War II. Unfortunately, not enough men today have taken the time to cultivate both the hardy and the refined sides of their manly character. It sometimes seems the gentleman is a dying breed. Common decency and respectful etiquette have been replaced with unrepentant rudeness. Today's men walk around ungroomed and wrinkled and ill-fitted clothing, and often have little regard for how their behavior affects others. But it doesn't have to be this way. Being a gentleman is more than following a bunch of do's and don'ts. It's about having a profound respect for yourself and for others. By following the simple tips contained in this chapter, any ruffian can turn into a proper gentleman. Developing the traits of a gentleman is a key to success in all aspects of your life. Business associates will respect you. Friends will flock to you. Women will adore you. Dress like a gentleman.
The difference between a man of sense and a fop is that the fop values himself upon his dress, and the man of sense laughs at it. At the same time, he knows he must not neglect it.
Lord Chesterfield. Judging a book by its cover may not be desirable, but it's initially the only evidence we have at our disposal. Within seconds of meeting you, people make judgments and decisions based on your appearance. What are your clothes telling them? That you're a disciplined, thoughtful guy with an eye for detail? or that you're just sliding by in life. Appearance matters. Dressing like a gentleman will boost your own confidence and win you the respect of others. Whether you're applying for a job or taking a lady out in the town, putting your best foot forward will maximize your chances for success, especially if that foot is covered by a well-shined shoe. Getting fitted for a suit. Like every good man, I strive for perfection, and, like every ordinary man, I have found that perfection is out of reach. But not the perfect suit. Edward Tivnan. There's no manlier outfit than a well-tailored suit. The reason they look so darn manly is that they originated from military uniforms. Every man should have at least one good suit that he can wear to job interviews, weddings, and a special night on the town. But picking out a suit is not like picking out a t-shirt and a pair of jeans. If you want to look and feel good in your suit, you need to take into account several factors. In a moment, we'll provide some things to keep in mind when you walk into a haberdashery to get fitted for a new suit. Follow them, and you'll leave the store with a long-lasting and dashingly handsome suit. The jacket. Getting the perfect fit. Fit the shoulder. The most important area you want to check for fit is in the shoulder or yoke area of the jacket. While you can alter a suit that doesn't fit in the shoulder, it's much more difficult than other areas of the jacket, and will thus cost more. You don't want the fabric in the shoulder to be so tight that it starts to bunch up. The shoulder and upper back area should lie flat along your body. Make sure the armholes are comfortable. When you lay your arms down at your side, it shouldn't feel like the armholes are digging their way into your armpits. If you can't put your arms down, you definitely have a problem. You don't want to be Randy in A Christmas Story, looking like a tick ready to pop. Again, while armholes can be altered, it's much more difficult and will cost you a lot of money. Check how the jacket drapes on your body. The suit should drape comfortably and freely on the front of your body. It shouldn't drape so much that you look like a 12-year-old borrowing your dad's suit. The lapels should lay flat on your chest. If they're not, it's too small. Finally, check the back. If the jacket has vents, then the vents should lay flat on your butt, i.e., your butt shouldn't be sticking out. If it is, you need to have the jacket altered so it fits larger around your front. Check the length of the jacket. The key here is to find balance. You don't want the jacket to be too long or too short. Your grandpa's tailor used to check for the proper length of the jacket by having him lay his arms at his side and cup his fingers. The jacket was fitted to where it met the inner curve of grandpa's fingers. The modern rule of thumb is that the jacket should be long enough to completely cover your butt, but no longer. Check the length of the sleeve. Sleeves should generally be long enough to show just a quarter length of shirt sleeve when you lay your arms flat at your side. You don't want the sleeve to break past your wrist. That's nerdy. Pants. Where should the trouser break? Wear your pants on your waist, not your hips. We're talking about your real waist here. For the past 20 years, men have been wearing their pants lower and lower around their hips. While this may be fine for jeans, wearing your pants very low does not work for trousers. A man should wear trousers at navel level, not below it. When your tailor is talking about the break in your trouser, he's talking about the point where your pants' hem falls on your shoes. If your break is too high, you'll look like Steve Urkel. If it's too low, your pants will swallow your dew beaters. You have three options for where the break is on your pant: the full break, the medium break, and the no break. The full break. The bottom of the hem covers the heel of the shoe. This option provides a much longer covering, keeping the pants from exposing one's socks when walking. The medium break. The bottom of the hem falls in the middle of the heel of the shoe. It provides less covering for the sock when walking, but keeps the fabric further away from the floor and reduces the chance of tripping. The no break. The bottom of the hem falls almost at the top of the heel of the shoe. When being measured for a no break hem, make sure the tailor doesn't go too high, or you'll show too much sock.
How to rock a pocket square.
What do Winston Churchill, Cary Grant, and James Bond have in common? In addition to enjoying a stiff drink, they all rocked a pocket square. Like the hat, the popularity of pocket squares waxes and wanes, and for too long men were neglecting the breast pockets of their suits. But the pocket square is currently enjoying a renaissance, popping up on the movers and shakers in Hollywood and hip-hop. Hell, even Saddam Hussein rocked a pocket square when he was on trial. A man should never defend his war crimes without one. The pocket square is back, with good reason. They're an easy and inexpensive way to vary the look of the same suit. Pocket squares add some visual interest and flair to your appearance. Every man just looks more dapper with a bit of fabric peeking out of his pocket. Pocket square guidelines. Don't leave your suit naked. A suit without a pocket square lacks finished panache. So, the first guideline of pocket square usage is to always wear one when you wear a suit or sport coat. It just looks better. Color coordinating. A pocket square can be patterned or solid. The general guideline is that your pocket square color should complement some color on your tie. So, if your tie is a bit of red, rock a solid red pocket square or a patterned pocket square with some red in it. However, avoid matching the colors exactly. It looks like you're trying too hard. So, never ever buy a tie and pocket square set at your local department store. A white pocket square can be worn with any color tie, making the white handkerchief an essential part of every man's collection. How to fold a pocket square. You have several options on how to fold your pocket square. Some are quite simple and others are complex. It all comes down to personal taste. Here are three simple folds that every man should master. The straight fold. The straight fold lends a classic look to your suit. What you'll end up with is a small rectangle peeking out of your breast pocket. Here's one way to fold it. 1. Lay your pocket square flat. 2. Bring the left side to the right side. 3. Bring the bottom towards the top, but don't fold it all the way. 4. Fold the fabric in thirds horizontally, so that it will fit in your suit pocket. The one-corner fold. With the one-corner fold, you'll have a small peak of fabric coming out your pocket. This one is my favorite of the three. Here's how to fold it. 1. Lay your pocket square on a flat surface, with one corner facing up and one corner facing down, so it looks like you have a baseball diamond in front of you. 2. Bring the bottom point to the top point, so that you create a triangle. 3. Bring the left corner of the triangle to the right corner, and the right corner to the left corner. You should end up with a long rectangle with a point at the top. It looks sort of like a fence slat. 4. Fold the bottom toward the top, but not all the way. 5. Place it in your suit. Adjust until you get the desired amount of point coming out of the pocket. The puff fold. The puff fold is the simplest of all the folds, as there's no actual folding involved. The result is a small puff of fabric coming out of your suit pocket. Here's how to do it. 1. Lay the pocket square flat. 2. Pinch the middle of the fabric, allowing the folds to come in naturally. 3. With one hand firmly holding the pocket square, use your other hand to gently gather it together. 4. Now gracefully gather up the bottom of the pocket square. 5. Place it in your suit. Fiddle with it until you get the desired puffiness. 3 ways to tie a tie. It's a sad fact, but there are grown men who don't know how to tie a necktie. If they have a big interview that afternoon, they'll go shopping for a clip-on. Even if a man does know how to tie a tie, their knowledge is often limited to just one knot. But there are several ways to tie a necktie. Certain knots should be used with certain shirt collars and tie fabric materials to get the best results for your appearance. In a moment, we'll show you 3 classic necktie knots every man should know and give you the lowdown on when you should use them. the Windsor knot. The Windsor knot gives you a wide, triangular knot that's good for more formal settings. This knot is best worn with a widespread collar. 1. Drape the tie around your neck. The wide end should extend about 12 inches below the narrow end of the tie. Cross the wide part of the tie over the narrow end. 2. Bring the wide end of the tie up through the hole between your collar and the tie, then pull it down toward the front. 3. Bring the wide end behind the narrow end and to the right. 4. Pull the wide end back through the loop again. You should have a triangle now where the knot will be. 5. Wrap the wide end around the triangle by pulling the wide end from right to left. 6. Bring the wide end up through the loop a third time. 7. Pull the wide end through the knot in front. 8. Tighten the knot and center it with both hands. The half Windsor knot. This is the Windsor knot's little brother. Like the Windsor, you're left with a symmetrical triangle knot, but the half Windsor is not as large. This knot is appropriate for lighter fabrics and wider ties. It's best worn with a standard collar. 1. Drape the tie around your neck. The wide end should extend about 12 inches below the narrow end of the tie. Cross the wide part of the tie over the narrow end. 2. Bring the wide end around and behind the narrow end. 3. Bring the wide end up and pull it down through the hole between your collar and the tie. 4. Bring the wide end around the front, over the narrow end from right to left. 5. Bring the wide end up back through the loop again. 6. Pull the wide end down through the knot in front. 7. Tighten the knot and center it with both hands. The four-in-hand knot. Also known as the schoolboy, this is probably the most widely used knot because it's so easy to tie. It's a good knot to use if your tie is made of heavier material. It looks best with smaller spread collars. 1. Drape the tie around your neck. The wide end should extend about 12 inches below the narrow end of the tie. Cross the wide part of the tie over the narrow end. 2. Turn the wide end back underneath the narrow end. 3. Continue wrapping the wide end around the narrow end by bringing it across the front of the narrow end again. 4. Pull the wide end up and through the back of the loop. 5. Hold the front of the knot with your index finger and bring the wide end down through the front knot. 6. Tighten the knot carefully to the gills by holding the narrow end and sliding the knot up. Center the knot. Bringing back the hat. And now for the ultimate finishing touch for any gentleman's outfit, the hat. Up until the 1950s, men were rarely seen out and about without a hat sitting upon their heads. Since that time, the wearing of hats has seen a precipitous decline. No one is sure why. Some say the downfall of hats occurred when JFK did not wear a hat to his inauguration, thus forever branding them as uncool. This is an urban myth, however, as Kennedy did indeed don a hat that day. Another theory posits that the shrinking size of cars made wearing a hat while driving prohibitively difficult. Most likely, the demise of hats can simply be traced to changing styles and the ongoing trend toward a more casual look. Yet, hats are due for a full resurgence. Hats are both functional and stylish. They can hide a bad hair day, cover a bald spot, keep your head warm, and shade your eyes from the sun. Hats supply a touch of class and sophistication, impart personality, and add an interesting and unique accent to your outfits. And hats are a surefire way to boost your confidence. A cool hat can quickly become your signature piece and give you extra swagger. The different kinds of hats. Of course, men today still wear hats, but they're most often confined to ratty baseball caps, hippie beanie caps, or the thankfully almost extinct trucker hat. There's nothing wrong with these kinds of headpieces per se, but there are other hat options out there. so mix up your lids with the following options. The flat cap. The flat cap has a rounded shape, a small brim, and a high back. Long associated with working-class men in the UK, the flat cap can be a stylish way to add interest to a casual outfit. They can give your tired jeans and t-shirt look unique style. Choose the more masculine flat cap over the similar but rounder and puffier newsboy cap. The latter has been almost entirely co-opted by the ladies. The fedora. Fedoras were once considered de rigueur for men going out in public, whether they were headed to work or a ball game. While once mainstream, a man in a fedora is now seen as a trendsetter. Fedoras are soft and usually made of felt, creased lengthwise down the crown and pinched on both sides. Fedoras will make you look manly and a bit mysterious. Worn by Prohibition-era gangsters, almost all of the movie stars of the 1940s, and old Blue Eyes himself, donning a fedora puts you in touch with a truly suave and manly heritage. The pork pie. Named for its resemblance to an actual pork pie, this hat is similar to a fedora, but with a flat top instead of a pinched crown. The brim is also shorter and turned up. The hat is often associated with the jazz, blues, and ska culture, but was also worn by the likes of Robert Oppenheimer, father of the atomic bomb. The Homburg. The Homburg is another hat similar to the fedora. The Homburg's brim lacks the fedora's pinches and is turned up all the way around. The hat is accented with a hat band into which a feather may be stuck. Less casual than a top hat and dressier than a fedora, the Homburg was the go-to lid for politicians and diplomats in the 20th century. Favored by the Godfather and resurrected by the likes of Snoop Dogg and Tupac, the Homburg now carries a distinctly gangster flavor. The bowler, or derby. Bowlers are hard, made of felt, and have very short brims. While considered a British icon, the bowler was also part of the urban culture of America in the 19th century. For example, one of the gangs that roamed the mean streets of New York City around this time was the Plug Uglies. The Uglies were never without their bowler hats, which they wore both as their signature piece and to protect their heads during their many scuffles with rival gangs. Trilby. If the bowler is largely known as a British hat, the trilby is distinctively American. Trilbies, with their deeply indented crown and narrow brim, share similarities with a Homburg and fedora, but have a style all their own. Although traditionally associated with the jazz culture and paired with dressier outfits, today a checkered or tweed trilby is often worn to top off a more casual outfit. Wear a hat with confidence. Cock your hat. Angles are attitudes. Frank Sinatra. Hats can give you a feeling of effortless, cool, and manly confidence. Few people loved hats more, or wore them better, than Frank Sinatra. He was constantly playing with the idea of angling and tilting his hat to convey different attitudes. Here's how you can wear your hat to reflect your mood. Wear your hat pushed back to seem more open and accessible. Tilt your hat over your eyes to seem mysterious and intimidating. Tilt your hat up 1 inch from completely straight to project an all-business attitude. Hat etiquette. The hat is a singular accessory. When and where you don it, doff it, and tip it conveys respect in a way no other piece of clothing can. In adopting the hat as your signature piece, you must also accept the responsibilities that go with it. Often ignored, hat etiquette will show that your uniqueness extends not only to your choice of headwear, but to your manners as well. Hats should always be removed at funerals and graveside services, inside Christian churches, during outdoor weddings, inside of homes, restaurants, and buildings, unless in the corridors or lobbies of the latter, when riding an elevator in the presence of a lady, during the national anthem, while eating meals, unless seated at the lunch counter of a diner, while conversing with someone, tip your hat when greeting a friend. When greeting a lady friend, remove your hat completely by the crown. Excusing yourself to a woman whom you've inadvertently jostled or are passing by in a tight space. Saying goodbye. Expressing gratitude. Thank you, and you're welcome. The perfect hat for your ugly mug. What we find attractive is largely based on symmetry. The more symmetrical a face is, the more appealing it appears to others. But there's not much we can do, short of surgery, to change the symmetry of our faces. There are ways to mitigate our asymmetries, however. You may have heard a woman in your life talk about getting a haircut that flatters her particular face shape. While dude haircuts don't come in enough varieties to have the same effect, there is another way guys can balance out their faces. Hats. All hats make a man look more dapper. But picking a hat that is right for your face shape will increase your attractiveness and give you an even sharper appearance. If you've been inspired to bring back the hat, but weren't sure what kind of hat to get, this guide will help you pick the right hat for your ugly mug. Anatomy of a hat. Before we get started, let's do a quick rundown of some of the terms we'll be using to fit a hat to your mug. Taper describes how narrow the top of the crown is compared to the bottom. A hat that tapers gets narrower near the top of the crown. With a hat that has no taper, the crown doesn't narrow as it gets to the top. Now let's match a hat to that ugly mug of yours. Short, full face. Your face is shaped like Jack Black. A round face tends to look short, so you want a hat that will give you a little height. Crown, medium height and size. Taper, slight. Hat band. Narrow band of a contrasting color will add height. Brim. Moderate width. Snap the brim to its full width and turn it up. Never snap it down, or it will make your face appear shorter. Tilt. Back from face. Tilting it over your face will make the face appear shorter. Recommended hats: fedora, gambler, Panama. Long, thin face. Your face is shaped like Will Arnett. Look for a hat that shortens the appearance of your face. Crown, shorter height. Avoid crowns that are square, full, or too high. Taper, moderate. Hat band, wide, will make your face shorter, with a contrasting color to break up your vertical lines. Brim, moderately wide, snap from ear to ear. Tilt, to the side with a slight back tilt. Recommended hat, fedora, Homburg, derby. Top-heavy face. Your face is shaped like John Favreau. The top-heavy face is wider on the top half and tapers to a narrower chin line. You want a hat that will balance out the top and bottom. Crown. Medium to short height, pinched toward the front. Avoid crowns that are full or too high. Taper. Moderate taper. Hat band. Medium to narrow, in a color similar to the color of the hat. Brim. Medium width, rolled at back and sides, flat in front. Tilt. To the side, and not too far back on the head, or you'll show too much of your wide forehead. Recommended hat. Fedora. Homburg. Square face. Your face is shaped like Orlando Bloom. Pick a hat that will add some curvature to your face and make it appear less boxy. Crown, medium height, full and round. Taper, minimal to non-existent. Brim, wide width, fully snapped or turned up. Tilt, a side tilt will break up your square face lines. Don't push it too far back on your head. Recommended hat, Homburg, bowler. Long nose. Your nose resembles Adrian Brody, although perhaps not that long. Pick a hat that will break up the line from the brim to the tip of your nose. Crown, medium height, and not pinched too tightly at the front. Taper, minimal to non-existent. Hat band, wide and colorful. brim. Wide width. You want it to extend beyond the tip of your nose. Tilt to the side. Recommended hat? Fedora. Prominent jaw. You've got a chin like Aaron Eckhart. Pick a hat that will balance your strong chin. Crown, medium or low height. Avoid crowns that are full or too high. Pick one with side dents. This adds just the right amount of fullness. Taper, slight. Brim, medium width, snapped fully across. Make sure it doesn't turn up in the back sharply, or it will make the jaw appear even more prominent. Tilt, level, with a side tilt. Recommended hat, fedora. Receding chin. You've got a chin like Paul Dano. Pick a hat that will draw attention upwards, away from the chin. Crown, low height. Taper, significant. Hat band, narrow. Brim, flat or very shallow snap. Tilt, level with significant side tilt. Recommended hat, pork pie, trilby. Prominent ears. Your ears stick out like Will Smith. If your ears are large or stick out, pick a hat that will cover them. Crown, full and moderately tall. Taper, minimal to slight. Brim, as wide as possible in order to cover the ears and make them seem smaller. Flat or fully snapped. Do not roll the brim, as this will highlight the ears. Tilt, down in the back. Recommended hat, gambler, Panama, wide-brimmed fedora. Attention to details. Even if you don a nicely fitted suit, tuck a piece of colorful fabric into your pocket, and tie your tie with precision, if you don't pay attention to the details of your appearance, your whole look and first impression will be ruined. There are three things to check before you head out for a night in the town or a job interview. Are your clothes ironed? Are your shoes shined? Do your socks, shoes, and belt coordinate with your suit? Refining these finishing touches will leave you looking like a square-rigged gentleman. Ironing your clothes. Preparing for ironing. Hang up your clothes immediately after drying. This will reduce the amount of wrinkles in your clothing, and consequently the amount of work you have to do with the iron. Fill her up. Fill the iron with water so you have plenty of steam to get those wrinkles out. Set the iron to the appropriate temperature. Different fabrics require different iron temperatures. If the iron is too hot or steamy, you'll ruin the fabric. Check the tag on the inside of your clothing to find the appropriate setting. Generally, for all cotton fabrics, set the temperature on high. Set it lower for part or all synthetics. If you have both synthetic and cotton fabrics to iron, start with the synthetics, so you won't have to wait for the iron to cool down after tackling the cotton. Iron on a padded surface. It makes ironing easier. If you don't have an ironing board, lay a towel over a desk. Dampen the garments. The key to good ironing is to start with slightly damp clothes. Take your shirt or pants out of the dryer before they completely dry. If your clothes are already dry, spray them down with some water until slightly damp. Ironing a dress shirt. You don't want to approach ironing haphazardly. It's not efficient or effective. This is a battle against wrinkles. Like any hard-fought battle, you need an attack plan if you want to come out on top. Iron your shirt in this order to get the best result possible. 1. Collar. Lay it flat, wrong side up, pressing from the points toward the center. Then, press it on the right side. 2. Yoke. The yoke is the panel that covers the shoulders. Lay it over the widest part of the ironing board to do the job. 3. Cuffs. Unbutton the cuffs and open them fully. Iron the insides, then the outsides. 4. Sleeves. Using the seams as your guide, smooth the sleeve flat with your palm and iron it. then flip it over and do the other side. Now iron the other sleeve. 5. Back. Lay it on the wide part of the ironing board too. 6. Front panels. Start with the pocket, then do the panels. The little point of the iron helps you press around buttons. 7. Retouch. Retouch the collar and cuffs if they need it. Ironing a pair of pants. Just as with your shirt, if you want to get the absolute best results, you need to iron your pants in a certain order. 1. Turn the pants inside out and iron the waistband, pockets, fly area, seams, and hems. 2. Turn the pants right side out and pull the waistband over the pointy end of the ironing board, as if you were dressing it. Iron the waistband area and the upper part of your pant. 3. Pull the pants off the ironing board. Hold them by the hems and line up the outer and inner seams together. Lay the pants along the ironing board lengthwise. 4. Bring the hem of the top pant leg toward the waistband. Iron the inside of the bottom pant leg from the hem to the crotch. Turn the pants over and repeat for the other leg. 5. Line up the pant legs on top of each other. Iron the outside of the top leg. Flip the pants over and repeat on the other pant leg. 6. Hang them up immediately, but don't just throw them on a hanger. To maintain that crease you so meticulously created, you want to hang your dress pants neatly. Grab the pants by the hem and find the crease. Bring the pants legs together and hold them together at the creases. You should see a nice straight line going down both sides of the pants. Once you have the pants lined up with a nice crease, take the hanger in one hand and slide it down the pants leg to about the middle. Gently fold the hem across the hanger. Give your shoes a mirrored shine. For a shoe so shiny that you can see your reflection in it, all you need is a soft cloth, a can of Kiwi shoe polish, and a good shoe brush. 1. To remove any dirt or mud or salt on your shoes, brush them off or rinse them under cold water. 2. Wrap part of the cloth around your index finger. Moisten the cloth at the fingertip with a small amount of water. Do not soak the entire rag. Some people swear by spit, others by lukewarm water, still others by cold water. Experiment and see what works best for you. Rub your now moist cloth in the polish to acquire a small amount. Make sure you match the color of shoe polish to the color of your shoe as precisely as you can. Do not dig divots in your polish, as it will create more surface area and cause it to dry out quicker, thus ruining a good can of polish. 3. Apply the polish in small circles, in very small amounts. Work one piece of the shoe at a time, toe, tongue, heel, inside upper and outside upper, until you have covered the whole shoe. This is your base coat. 4. Grab your shoe brush and brush the entire shoe vigorously. 5. Moisten your cloth and rub it in the polish again. Start buffing the boot or shoe by going over the entire shoe in small circles with a light amount of pressure. Breathe hot air onto the boot or shoe as if trying to fog a mirror. This adds a slight amount of moisture to the boot and softens the outer layer of polish slightly, filling in the unseen cracks and allowing the shoe or boot to become perfectly smooth and shiny. Continue until you get the preferred amount of shininess. If you ever need a quick shine, just rub your shoe on the back of your pant leg. This is how Gramps did it in a pinch. Manly advice. Color coordinating your...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.